welcome to the second episode of New Dad on Old Movies. I'm your host, Jason the New Dad, and I'm joined again live, this time in person, by my daughter Indy. Say hello, Indy. So I've been a dad for a month and a day, and I just had a haircut. This channel is intended as a casual primer for classic movies. I'll be focusing mainly on the ones I think most people have heard of, but perhaps not seen. The guidelines: every film is one I like, every film is from before 1970, and every film is available on Blu-ray or DVD. So let's get to it, and hopefully, maybe, someday my daughter will actually want to watch these movies. In this episode, we're looking at the 1967 thriller Wait Until Dark, starring Audrey Hepburn, Richard Crenna, and Alan Arkin. It was released around Halloween that year, and is still one of the scariest movies from that era. Just ask my mother. No, seriously, just ask my mother. Wait Until Dark is based on a stage play of the same name by Frederick Knott, and frankly, the stage origins show. There's basically only one location, and the camera doesn't bother spending too much time outside of it. Fun fact, Arkin's villainous role of Rote was played on stage by Robert Duvall, so now that's in your brain cells. It was directed by Terrence Young, whose most notable credits were three early James Bond pictures, Dr. No, From Russia with Love, and Thunderball. During World War II, Terrence Young was a paratrooper and was rumored to have met Hepburn while serving in Holland. Although even with intense Googling, I was unable to confirm or deny that information. So if you know either way, sound off in the comments. The film was produced by Mel Ferrer, probably most famous for being Audrey Hepburn's husband, well, until 1 year after this movie when they divorced. I guess love is not blind, because she's blind in the movie. Dad joke. It was Audrey's height of fame, and Alan Arkin should be grateful because he got the villain role easily because no other actors wanted to play the guy who's mean to Audrey Hepburn. That's how beloved she was. On a personal note, I'm sorry for saying that Katharine Hepburn is the better Hepburn in the last episode. Anyway, let's get to the setup. The movie begins with the Warner Brothers logo, transitioning into someone performing surgery on a doll. An older gentleman named Louis is removing the stuffing from the doll and filling it with packets of heroin. He stitches up the doll while his accomplice, Lisa, puts on a fantabulous fur coat. She leaves with the doll as Louis warns her to be careful.
Be careful, Lisa.
Lisa hails a cab while the soundtrack plays a theme that John Carpenter surely borrowed a wee bit when he made Halloween 11 years later. It is a Henry Mancini score, so if you're gonna borrow ideas, borrow from the best. Louis watches from the window as she pulls away and makes a phone call. At the airport, we are treated to some very subtle credits. Lisa checks into her Air Canada flight to New York, brazenly carrying her totally dope doll. Get it? Doll's dope. Dad joke, sorry. As she boards the airplane, she catches the dropped medication of the man in front of her, Sam Hendricks. Fun fact, Sam is played by Ephraim Zimbalist Jr., son of the unsurprisingly named Ephraim Zimbalist Sr., a renowned concert violinist. Jr. would go on to voice Alfred Pennyworth in over a decade's worth of various animated Batman series slash movies. As she disembarks in New York, she is watched from afar by Rote, Alan Arkin in a trilby and sunglasses. With more music that inspired Halloween, Lisa spots Rote and seems justifiably concerned. Lisa begs the medication dude from earlier to take her doll. We see why as Rote is there to greet her. As Rote escorts her away, Sam leaves the airport, the smack doll stuffed in his suitcase. On the streets of New York, Carlino and Mike, played by Rambo's boss Richard Crenna, ask some local youths if this is St. Luke's place, and get menacing when the kids get sassy. They enter a dark apartment building and find a note stuck to the door from Lisa, telling them to come in. They wander around the apartment, Halloween-y music playing. Carlino helps himself to an apple, while Mike snoops around, seeing an old war photo from Charlie Company. Carlino starts helping himself to even more food from the fridge, while Mike continues snooping till he finds a photo that reveals Sam Hendricks is the husband of Audrey Hepburn's character, Susie. Mike realizes that this isn't Lisa's place, and that Lisa probably didn't write the note, given that she can't type. As they move to leave, the door rattles and opens to reveal Rote. I just like saying Rote. Rote reveals that he knows both of their names and that they used to run scams with Lisa, where they would catch her in bed with husbands and blackmail them. Now she works with Rote, and he's prepared to offer them $2,000 each if they can retrieve an item for him, a doll.
What kind of doll?
An ordinary doll, a child's doll.
A doll that has gone missing. Carlino points out that it's probably in the safe, and Rote tells them that their job is to talk their way into the safe. They want into the locked closet in the back, but Rote pretends not to have the key. When Mike catches Rote in a lie, zing, out comes a knife. Suddenly everyone is armed with random chairs and tuna fish, and tensions couldn't be higher, and Rote drops the knife and sits calmly. Mike gets the key and opens the closet. And discovers Lisa. Rote says that she was intruding on his business, and that's why he killed her. He also reveals that he was very careful to not touch anything with his bare hands in that apartment, and that Mike and Carlino have put their prints all over the place. He tells them that they have to help dispose of the body, and they start to comply when Audrey Hepburn finally Hep plays Susie, and Susie enters. The men realize she is blind. And that's where I'll leave it. The bad guys and the really bad guy think that the doll is in her home. How can Susie protect herself from three hardened criminals? Is Lisa okay? No, she's not. Where is the doll? Watch and find out. I gotta give the Scene Stealer Award to Alan Arkin. He really became known in his later years for his comic turns in such films as Little Miss Sunshine and Gross Point Blank. And it's nice to know that Arkin was scaring the crap out of my mom in 1967. Seriously, the moment when Rote jumps out at Hep totally traumatized her. She can watch Seven, but I don't think she could ever watch this movie again. Hey, what if we made Wait Until Dark, but the woman was deaf instead of blind? Then you get a masterful horror thriller like Hush. Hush was directed by Mike Flanagan, who also made the better-than-expected Oculus, Gerald's Game, and last year's hit Netflix series The Haunting of Hill House. And he made a sequel to the Ouija movie, and it's actually good. Flanagan is the real deal. Flanagan wrote Hush with his wife, Kate Siegel, the star of the film, whom you'll recognize if you're a Hill House fan. Hush is terrific, although fans of Wait Until Dark should know that Hush is significantly more modern in its depiction of violence. So those of you with sensitive constitutions, instead of Hush, try a double feature with David Fincher's Panic Room, starring Jodie Foster. Another film about a woman defending her home from a group of criminals who want something hidden inside. So let me know what you think. Would you watch a double feature of Hush and Wait Until Dark? What about Panic Room and Wait Until Dark? Was Alan Arkin's performance really all that good? Is the baby thing getting old? Oh, you can't get old. Let me know in the comments, and if you like this video, please like and subscribe. Thank you. Until next time, I'm just gonna go. And here's a second of footage from the next episode.